You may be seated. We are gathered here today to celebrate the life and the legacy of David Neely. David was a fine man who lived life to the fullest. And we know that David passed away and he passed into the gates of heaven on Saturday, May 18, 2024. The family is so appreciative and thankful and grateful of your support and love that has been shown to the family during this time. I would like to open up and read some scripture found from Psalm 23, starting with verse 1, and I want to read all the way down to verse 6, and I'm reading this out of the New King James, but it's the 23rd Psalm. It says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul." How many of you today are grateful and thankful that when you're in the worst season of your life, that God can restore? He's a God that wants to restore you today if your heart is broken. "He restores my soul. He leads me into the path of righteousness for his namesake." Verse 4 says, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runneth over." And verse 6 says this, "Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of our lives, and we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." How many of you are grateful and thankful that grace and mercy and God's goodness follows you all the days of our lives? Because a lot of times, if we're honest, we wake up and we say, "The devil is on my back." But how many of you know we should be saying that goodness and mercy and grace and all of God's goodness is following us all the days of our lives? Take comfort in God's word. Amen? So let us open up in prayer today. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we thank you, Lord, for David Neely. God, we thank you, Lord, for the life and the legacy that he lived out among his family and friends. What a great man he was to many, many people, Lord. And today, Lord, I pray, God, that you would comfort family and friends. God, I pray, God, that you would come and wrap your loving arms around them. God, I pray that your goodness, your mercy, and grace will follow them all the days of their lives as they follow hard after you, Lord. And I pray, God, that you would just touch each person under the sound of my voice, Lord. We are saddened by David's loss, but Lord, we rejoice today because we know that he is in a better place. We know that he is with his Lord and Savior. We know that he has been reunited with his wife, Jackie. And Lord, I just pray that you would comfort family and friends. And God, we celebrate the life and the legacy of David. And Lord, we know that he is in heaven, walking the streets of gold. And Lord, we pray that you would touch every single person under the sound of my voice. And Lord, we pray that you would bless this service. And God, have your way as we commit this service to you. We celebrate the life and the legacy of David. And Lord, we love you, we praise you, and we thank you for your grace, your mercy, and your love. And Lord, we love you and praise you. And all the people who love the Lord said, amen. Amen.
In my eyes. could tell you I'd tell a tale sure to make you smile. If I have a wish that I could wish for, make a wish for sunshine all the while. Sunshine on my shoulders makes me happy. Sunshine in my
good afternoon, folks. For those of you who don't know me, my name is John Godfrey. I grew up here in Calhoun Falls. And about 70 some odd years ago, the good Lord knew that there were two little boys that needed a friend. And he put me and David together. We were inseparable. You never saw me without David or David without me. Very rarely. And most of the time, Dennis and his brother Jimmy and Betty Jo would be tagging along. And if we were at the house, Betty Jo would be following Mother around like a puppy dog. But we were inseparable. I know Jennifer asked me, did we have any pictures of us when we were small? And there's one picture on that slideshow of us. And I told her, no, we didn't take pictures. And as I was telling Dennis, there's one good thing about it. There's no proof. There's nobody, you can't prove anything that we did. But David and I don't know, I was trying to think when we became friends. And to be honest, I can't remember not having David as a friend. He is the best friend that I ever had in this world. In my 80 years, I've had a lot of friends, but I've never had one like David Neely. Never. We, as what often happens in the textile industry, my father got transferred out in 1958. And in the summer of 58, and we were separated. Not long after that, Dennis's family moved to Fort Mill. And I saw David a couple of times in the summer. And then when I entered Clemson, I came and watched him play football one time. And then after that, we lost each other. We lost each other for a long time. He went in the Air Force, of course, as y'all know, and met a girl in Texas and decided to become a Texan. I was in North Carolina working for the textile industry. And then thanks to social media, I started finding people that I went to school with, and Judy and Sandy Healy and some others. And one day I got a message from Judy saying, David's gonna be in South Carolina. can you come to Greenville and we meet for that day? And we did. Now, honestly, that was the last time I saw David, but we talked regularly on the phone. I remember talking to him right after his mother died, and I didn't know what to say to him. I didn't know anything I could say, but I could tell that he was hurt terribly. But we talked many times together. And the last time we talked, Jennifer let me know that David was going to call me. And that was the last time we talked when he called. And I thought about then how weak he sounded. And I had made plans for this summer that I was going to get with Jennifer, and I was going to fly out to Austin and surprise David. But God had other plans. God in May told his angels, go get him. He's suffered enough. It's his time to come home. As another David, who was happened to be king of Israel way back, said when he had an infant child to die, he said, he can't come back to me, but I can go to him. And we know that we'll see David again. We know we'll see him. And I will tell you that if we could talk to David, there's no way he'd come back. As much as he loves all of us, there's no way he would come back, and I don't think any of us would want him to. But we can go to him. And I would guarantee you that he would tell us one thing, if we could get a message from him, is tell people about Jesus. Tell people about Jesus, because I want him here with me. And so I can pass that on to you. And in closing, I'd like to say, if I could say anything to David, it would be, old friend, I will see you again. It won't be as long as it has been. I don't know how long it'll be, but it won't be as long as it has been. And we'll just take a couple thousand years out of eternity and get caught up. We'll get caught up. And brother, I will meet you at the feet of Jesus. Thank you.
I'm not good at this, but I got to say it. I've had two heroes in my life, Jesus and David. I was his uncle, but it was more like he was my brother. I can't express how much of a example he set for me. If you know David, you love him. And I know these people here tonight or today really knows David, how deep his heart was. He touched my life in so many ways. And he's part of what I am today. I got to talk to him a lot. And I'd always tell him, I wouldn't let him forget, David, you're my hero. And I remember things he did. One example was lightning has struck the transformers down here at the mill. Well, of course, everybody was running around panicking. We didn't have a real fire department, we had volunteers. But anyway, somebody's mentioned that we got to cut them transformers off. Well, David was the first one to climb the fence and shut it off. He was risking his life. I can't imagine how much danger he was in, but he never thought about it. He thought about the others. It's like I said, to know him is to love him. And I know his friends love him. And I thank y'all for letting me say this. Thank you.
David Neely, 78 years old. As we've already heard, David was a blessing and a hero to many people. I didn't know David personally, but over the last week, I feel like I have learned a lot about David from what I've heard and from what I've read. And I've heard a lot of great things about David. And how many of you know we need to keep the main thing the main thing? And the main thing is David had a strong faith. David had an intimate, personal relationship with Jesus. And David served his community well. And he was consistent in pursuing those who chose to break the law. David's faith helped him to be a brave and bold in serving his community. David's faith helped him to be a police officer that made a difference. How many of you know that in life we need a lot of God in order to be successful? And we especially, those that are police officers, need a lot of God to help them to be successful. And I believe that as a police officer, one of the things you need is God's protection. And David had God's protection throughout the years. God's protection was on and over and in David's life as he served as a police officer. On a tombstone, there's two dates. You got the year you were born and the year you die. And right in between, right smack dab in the middle of those two dates, is this little dash. And a lot of times we think the dash is insignificant. A lot of times we think the dash is not important. But that little dash is significant. That little dash is important because it represents our life. And from what I've read and from what I heard, we know that David Neely had a strong faith and that he made a difference in the 78 years that he was on this big old ball of dirt. David and Jackie and the kids, they were member of a Pentecostal church. They were members of the First Assembly of God Church in Texas. And again, they had a strong faith. Both David and his wife had a relationship with the Lord. And David and Jackie were separated by Jackie's death in November of 2019. But we know as of this year, as of May of 2024, that David and Jackie are now reunited in heaven. And that was made possible because, again, both Jackie and David had a personal relationship with the Lord. David loved his family. And David and Jackie both wanted the kids to know the Lord. That's the most important thing. How many of you know that success is found in simply having a relationship with Jesus? David had a servant's heart. And that's one of the traits that David possessed, and he maximized his potential in helping and serving others. Like Jesus, he would serve. David was the hands and feet of Jesus everywhere he went. David, from what I've heard and from what I've learned already, David was a good man, but not only was he a good man, I believe that he was God's man. Amen? David was caring, he was generous, and he always took good care of his family. David was a family man. In life, the two most important things is having a relationship with Jesus, number one, and then secondly, is your family. And David loved golf. And I heard if you're real good at golf, you can call yourself a golfer. And if you're not good at golf, then you simply just say, I play golf. But David loved golf. And David organized yearly golf fundraisers to raise college scholarships for disadvantaged and deserving youth. One thing about David, from what I've learned, is David was somebody you could depend on. David was somebody who was reliable. And in my opinion, those are some of the best people. Those that you can rely and depend on all throughout life. David, early in his life, he was in the Air Force. And once his time ended, David transitioned from the Air Force to the police department. And David had a passion for it. And David loved law enforcement, and he ended up becoming a sergeant in the armed robbery division. Jennifer, Rick, and Robert would tell you that David would present himself as a rough, tough dude, but they all knew that deep within, David had a soft spot. David worked out of the Maine police headquarters, and he ended up retiring as a senior sergeant in the repeat offenders program. David was also a part of that group that started and developed the Austin Police Department pension plan. When it was all said and done, at the end of the day, when it was all said and done, David retired with 28 years of service to the Austin Police Department in Texas. Jennifer shared an interesting story about David that one night around 2 a.m., she answered the family telephone. And it was a call from a snitch informant David worked with. And he rather rudely told Jennifer that he needed to talk to her dad, David. Long story short, he had information on the location of a most wanted fugitive. Jennifer said that her dad left the house, and within 15 minutes, with backup help, David arrested the fugitive. And that arrest led David to be on a segment of America's Most Wanted. During interrogations, more than a few criminals came to know the cold, hard stare of Senior Sergeant David Neely. David served his community well. He loved God, he loved his family, And we know that he served his community well. And for those today, I just want to spend a few moments. And I just want to comfort family and friends. In Scripture, in the New Testament, we see that one out of every 30 verses, it talks about the second coming of Christ. One out of every 30 verses in the New Testament talks about the return of Christ. So we know that one day, if we have that personal, intimate, ongoing, continual relationship with Jesus, we know that one day we're going to see David again in heaven. We know that David is now reunited with his wife, Jackie. And today we're not saying goodbye, but today we are simply saying, David, we will see you on the other side. David, we will see you in glory land. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 through 2. I won't read it for the sake of time, but I just want to paraphrase it. It talks about that we are in a race. How many of you know that? As Christians, we are in a race. And this Christian race isn't a sprint, but this Christian race is more of a marathon. And how many of you know we need to slow down and pace ourselves so that we don't get burned out? But the Bible talks about there's a great cloud of witnesses. We know today that David is in heaven and David is looking down. And I believe that he is cheering on family and friends and he is pulling for you and he's cheering you on as you run your race. David, from what I've heard, fought the good fight of faith. And we now know that David is resting in the presence of Jesus. And he's looking down on us today. And I believe that David would say, run your race full of faith and finish strong. How many of you know it's not so much about how we start in life, but it's all about how we finish. Amen? Family and friends, just know today, I just want to remind you and let you know, family and friends, that Jesus is stronger than the struggle. You may say, Pastor, I'm struggling. You may say, Pastor, I'm struggling. My heart is broken. My heart is shattered. Can I encourage you with a verse found in the book of Psalm? The Bible says that God is close to the brokenhearted. How many of you receive that? God is close. God is near to the brokenhearted. And he saves those who are crushed in spirit. And the Bible also tells us this great promise that we find in the Bible, that we find in James. The Bible says if we draw near to God, God will draw near to us. God will draw near to us. And some of you are saying, Pastor, why do I have to take the first step? You didn't. Jesus did over 2,000 years ago when he died on the cross. He took the first step, and now all we need to do is take a step toward him. God loves you so much, even in the middle of tragedy, even in the middle of the struggle, even in the middle of life's toughest circumstances. Just know that God loves you and he is near. The Bible talks about it in the New Testament, about the love of Christ, about how God's love is wide and long and deep and high. We can't even comprehend the love that God has for his children. So God knows us. How many of you know God knows us? He knows every detail of our life. He knows the number of hairs on our head. God knows us the best, the good, the ugly, and the bad. But yet, he loves us the most. In Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20, it says, just summing up that verse in three words, it says, God is able. Maybe today your heart is broken. Maybe today you are saddened. But I just want to let you know that God is able. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20, that God is able to do exceedingly, abundantly more than what we can ask, think, or imagine according to his power that works on the inside of us. So God is able. If you're hurting, I just want to challenge you, family and friends, to lean into his presence. And God is able to dump truckloads of grace and mercy and peace and healing into your life. Would you just If you don't mind, would you just lift up your hands right now? And can we just receive God's love right now? Even in the middle of life's toughest circumstances, can we just receive God's love? So just, if you don't mind, just lift up your hands right now and just say, God, fill me with your love. I'm not going to drag it out, but I just want us to say, God, fill me. Fill us. Fill family and friends with your love and comfort each one of them. Lord, I pray, God, that you would just wrap your loving arms around them, and may they lean into your presence during this time like never before. Lord, we thank you for your great love. And I want to close with this scripture. It's found in Matthew 11, verse 28. And this is the invitation from Jesus. This is the invitation from heaven. The first three words in that verse, Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, Jesus, this is Jesus talking. This is red letter stuff. Jesus says, come to me. If you're weary, if you're burdened, if you're tired, if you're broken, the invitation from Jesus is to come to him. And how many of you know we can cast all of our cares upon him because he cares for us? We can cast all of our cares upon him and God will sustain us in this season. How many of you are grateful that you serve a God that will comfort you in the midst of life's toughest circumstances? At this time, I'm going to open it up for the congregation. If there's any family, if there's any friends that would like to take a moment and stand up and share anything about David, I'm not going to drag it out, but just going to give you a moment or two. If there's anybody in the congregation that would like to stand and just share something about David, maybe a story or whatever you have, I'm going to open it up to anybody. Give you another 10 seconds. If not, we're going to move forward.
Are able, please rise for the rendering of military honors.
Thank you.
Let us close in prayer today. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we come before you today. God, we thank you for another day to live, to love, and to serve you. God, we thank you for the life and the legacy of David. God, I pray, Lord, that you would be with family. God, you would be with friends today, Lord. And God, I pray that you would just continually, consistently, and constantly wrap your loving arms around them and give us strength as we head to the graveside. And Lord, I pray, God, that you would be with every person. Lord, I pray, God, that you would be with every family, every friend, Lord. And I pray, God, that you would give them strength, Lord. You said in your word that as our days are, so shall our strength be. And Lord, we know that with each passing day, God, you will give us strength. You will give us strength, not just so that we can get by, but Lord, we know that you would give us strength so that we can do what it is that you have called us to do, Lord. And God, we thank you for the life and the legacy of David. And God, we know that his legacy and his life will live on forever in the hearts and the lives of family and friends. And Lord, help us today, Lord. Lord, we know that David, we believe that David is looking down on us, God, and he's cheering us on, Lord, as we run our race. And I pray, God, that every person under the sound of my voice, Lord, that we would run our race, that we would run it full of faith, and we would finish strong, just like David Neely did. And Lord, be with us today, Lord. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. God, we thank you for your blood that was shed on Calvary over 2,000 years ago. And Lord, I pray, God, that we would just continually lean into your presence, God. And Lord, we know that you're able. God, we lean into your love in this season. We lean into your joy and into your peace, God. And Lord, be with us. And we thank you, we praise you, and we honor you today. And Lord, we honor the life of David. And God, we thank you for every blessing and every gift that you have given us. And Lord, we love you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. We want to encourage you to follow us to the cemetery for the graveside service. I promise I will be brief due to the heat, but at this time, we are going to head to the graveside for the graveside service. Thank you, and it was an honor to be able to do David's service.